All right. 9 minutes after the hour of 12 o'clock, and it's part 7 of our continuing history of the jazz drums here on WKCR-FM in New York, 89.9 on your FM dial. Lauren Schoenberg here with my special guest host, Mel Lewis. Welcome back for yet another week.
Oh, it was wonderful to be back.
On the last show, we got into some of the great drummers of jazz. We talked about Tiny Khan and about Art Blakey.
Right.
And I think I'd originally announced Roy Haynes at the beginning of that show, but the way it's working out, we're stretching out and we're playing more material. And so we decided to do Roy Haynes today. Again, Roy Haynes and Philly Joe Jones will be our topics, the drummers that we're going to listen today in the continuing history of jazz drums. In case you're just tuning in, Mel's been with us for the last 6 shows, reprising a series that we did several years ago. The history of jazz drums. We began with people like Baby Dodds and Zooey Singleton and Gene Krupa and Chick Webb and Sid Catlett, etc. And now we're working our way up into more contemporary times. We're going to begin with Roy Haynes, and we'll begin with a broadcast that he did with really the one of the first bands that he came to national prominence with, and that, of course, was the Lester Young small group of the late 1940s. And I believe he took the place of Lindell Marshall, who was Wendell Marshall's brother. He joined Lester in December 1947. In fact, I read an interview with Roy Haynes where he said he remembered the first gig he did with Lester was at Town Hall in New York with Sarah Vaughan on the bill. And wouldn't you know that a complete recording of that concert has turned up recently. And fortunately, we can't play it for you because it's in litigation or something like that at the present moment. So we won't hear the very first recordings of Roy Haynes with Lester. He also recorded with Lester for the Aladdin label in late 1947. But we will listen to live material from the Royal Roost. And in selecting the material for the show, Mel has so importantly requested that whenever possible, I find live material by the drummers as opposed to studio material. Could you explain why?
Well, because... You know, studios have always had a tendency to cause musicians in general, you know, it doesn't matter who they are, to sort of hold back because of that. Of course, you always had a producer in the booth who would stop the tape right in the middle of a great chorus because you squeaked or you made a mistake or you hit a clam, you know, which is sort of stupid, but that's producers, and which most of them, you know, used to be an old joke about the an ad in the New York Times for record producers, no experience necessary. You know. So, I mean, there have been some wonderful ones. Don't get me wrong. But in general, the best producers of good records would be musicians themselves, you know, deciding on what they think was best for them, you know. And, but when that red light goes on in the studio, you have there's a tendency to be a little cautious. Drummers will hold back, they'll play lighter, they won't play as strong. When they're on a live performance with that audience out there, all hell breaks loose. Yeah. I mean, they just say, hey, I'm here to play. There might be dancing going on out in front, or it's a nightclub, whatever, with a good audience. And the smoke is there, even though that's terrible too, but I mean, it's there. And the drinks, you know, and so on, and after a... You play your best. I mean, you take chances. Mm-hmm. And that's why I prefer to hear, and drummers especially, will really go nuts on a live date. And they'll really play, especially if they don't know they're being recorded.
Yeah.
And generally they don't. You know, they don't know something's happening, you know. And even if they do know, it's that audience. There's that give and take thing between the audience and the musicians.
Yeah. Right, it's like there's something else to focus on. You're not focusing on the fact that you're in a recording studio and that they're timing it. You're focusing that's a live performance.
Well, you're looking at 4 walls in a recording studio, right. You know, it's just not the same.
So let's go to Roy Haynes right now. He's a very young gentleman from New England playing with Lester Young. We'll hear Lester Leapson and Sweet George Brown. So let's remember that these were recorded in late 1948, so we can place them in the proper time frame.
And so once again, ladies and gentlemen, we bring you the great press. Lester Young and his sextet featuring Jesse Drakes on trumpet, Ted Kelly on trombone, Roy Haynes on drums, Tex Briscoe on bass, and Freddie Jefferson on piano. bringing to you the sensational, the gentleman of tenor, the great Prez, Lester Young, here at the Royal Roost, ladies and gentlemen. And to start things, gentlemen, without wasting any more time, here's Lester Young in a record that everybody asked for. Lester leaps in. Thank you.
Yeah, you know what's nice about that for me is that, see, I met Roy, Mr. Loy. I call him Mr. Loy, by the way. We're very good friends, Roy and I, and as I am with everybody else too. But I mean, Roy and I got a special thing. We went to Japan together in 1970 for George Wein's drum festival. He and I and Jack DeJohnette, and we had a lot of fun. So it's a remembrance of the great times we had. Again, I'm chewing on butterscotch, folks. I'm
yeah. Yeah.
Anyway, I first met Roy in Baltimore, and he's playing the Prez's group. After I was with Boyd Rayburn's band then, and after I finished our show, a few of us went down to catch them, and I forget the name of the place. Roy would probably remember. It was a bar. They were up on a bar, and he just knocked me out. And Prez sounded so good. And then that night we all hung out, Prez and Roy and me and a couple other people at the hotel, because we were all staying. I think we were staying at the same place. I think it was a hotel Royal or something like that. We got to know each other pretty well, and Roy was the first drummer to let me sit in at Birdland. I mean, I sat in for him one night. He said, "Yeah, come on up," you know. And Bud Powell was, and Curly Russell and Zoot, and I think Red Rodney was playing. I'm not sure, but anyway, it was a lot of fun. And he was really nice about things like that. And I've never forgotten that, because he had no fear of his own. You're not going to blow him down. He's me. I mean, he had his confidence, why he didn't become more famous in the 40s than he did, because he was saying a lot, you know, I don't know. I really don't know.
Maybe it was, as we'll get into, winding up in the trio behind Sarah Vaughan was marvelous and a great gig for many years, but possibly that kind of would keep you off the jazz lists.
Well, I think he took that job because he needed to work and he had a family, you know, and he wanted to get it going. And working with Sarah, who was great anyway, you know, was a chance for him to know he's going to get that check every week, and at the same time play with somebody who was tasty and good trios and all that. But it cost him, it took him out of the picture for about 5 years. I mean, he was gone from the mainstream jazz scene. You know, he was out working with her, and except for in a festival here or there or a club in New York once in a while, or in L.A. or someplace. I mean, he was on the road with her. And also, Roy was really the original avant-garde drummer. I mean, if you notice what he's doing there behind Lester, he's doing the kind of things Max Roach did in bebop, but stretching it even further, to where he's crossing with that bass drum. Man, he's crossing some bars. And that's nervy and good. A lot of musicians, I don't think a lot of horn players, Prez with his swing, could appreciate it. It was inspiring. But I think there's a lot of people around that didn't know what was happening and would get lost and things like that. And, you know, Roy was, man, this is me and this is what I want to do. And to me, I loved it, you know. And I think he was doing what Elvin did later on, way before, you know. I mean, he was really into some things. But again... When he left that scene and went out with Sarah, which was a security, it's still a good move. I'd still say he did the right thing, because he raised his family and he had, you know, he didn't live like a human being. So he had to be doing something right there, and he certainly didn't lose anything in his playing for the years. It's just that we didn't get to hear him so often with playing with the Beboppers, which is where he should have really been.
Yeah.
But he went on and on. And maintained his integrity, and to this day, I mean, Roy has always been a sharp dresser.
He's always
a gentleman, you know. He's a nice cat. I really like him.
It's 12:27. We're talking with Mel Lewis here on the history of jazz drums. We're getting into Roy Haynes. We just heard some early Roy Haynes, 1948. Let's listen to some more titles recorded in the interim between when he was with Lester Young and then the years with Charlie Parker before going out with Sarah Vaughan in the 1950s. And we also will hear some beautiful things with Sarah Vaughan. This is the next session, is from January 1951, the Miles Davis Sextet. And the band here is Sonny Rollins on tenor, Benny Green trombone, John Lewis on piano, Percy Heath on the bass, and Roy Haynes on the drums. And this is something really far out. It's an original by John Lewis. And can't think of anyone else who could have played it like this except Roy Haynes. This is called Morpheus, and we'll follow it with a trio with Al Haig on the piano. Thank you. Just heard Roy Haynes in three settings. The first one with very avant-garde for its day. It still sounds very fresh. Morpheus, written by John Lewis, recorded by Miles Davis in 1951. Sonny Rollins, Benny Green, John Lewis, Percy Heath, and Roy Haynes on that. And we followed that with a trio just to hear some nice brushwork from Roy, along with Tommy Potter and Al Haig. And we heard, I believe that was Stairway to the Stars from 1950. And then we concluded there with Charlie Parker and Roy Haynes in 1954, I Get a Kick Out of You. Mel Lewis.
But that you know, now that was a nice way. It was a nice medley of tunes to show three sides of Roy, you know. Knocked me out on the brushwork on the trio was just simple, straight ahead, tasty, nice sound, nice feel. Which is what it should be. I mean, a man knows how to play brushes. And then on this last piece with Bird, you know, it's like the first chorus, hi-hat, you know, which is, all the great drummers did that. Always the first chorus is hi-hat. That's the way it's supposed to be, you know. Then you go to your ride cymbal. And you'll notice that on the ride cymbal, there's an emphasis on one and three. Da 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 one, you know, three, one, three. That's it. That's where the swing comes from, you know. I mean, the whole thing is just going down that way. And because the two and the four, the hi-hat's there for two and four. I mean, there's enough. But one and three, there's never enough unless you play it. And you got to do that on the top cymbal. And he did it. Then he gets that nice sound on his drums. They're tuned beautifully. You know, on that tour to Japan, Roy used he carried a timpani, a tunable. He carried a small timpani. Instead of a big tom-tom, he had a timpani on the right-hand side with a... That he did. Oh, he did all kinds of things with it, with his hand. He had all kinds of glisses and all that. It had a hand, whatever you call it, like a ratchet type of thing. Mm-hmm. It was a small timp, you know, about maybe 20 inches, 18 inches, 18 or 20 inch timpani, and attached to his regular set of drums, his lovely drums, and. And he did some wonderful things on his solos. And I had a normal set, and Dejanet had a pedal timpani. I mean, a pedal tom-tom
right.
that he was doing his things with. But watching Roy go with the hand, he really had a great range on the drum with that anyway. And it was always weird. We had a lot of fun. Yeah. The only thing about that trip was very funny is that there was a Japanese drummer on the bill with us. George Otsuka was his name. And this was a two-week tour. Now, every night, the show always started with George. He was first. And then I would be second, and I used members of Roy's group. I used, who the heck was there? Benny, tenor player. He was very good. Played baritone. He played sax, tenor and bass clarinet.
Benny Maupin.
Benny Maupin. I used him. He'd come out, because they'd come out and play solo with me. And Charles Sullivan. And bass player was Vishnu. Yeah. Bill Woods, but Vishnu's new name. And we had a ball. I mean, you know, Roy used them, and actually it was his own group, the hip ensemble. I used them individually because Jack, he came out and did something too with Benny Maupin with the flute and all that, you know, pretty wild stuff. But all of a sudden, one day, we're standing in the wings and we hear George and...
George Ween?
No, George Otsuka. It was the George Ween tour. Right. We hear George Otsuka, or Otsuka, I guess it is. And all of a sudden, I hear my solo, my everything. I mean, and the next night, we hear Roy. And then we hear Jack DeJohnette. This guy got all of us down, pat, and he was using our scene. So we had to go up there and change everything.
Oh.
he created the thing where we had to create something new. It was really funny. It was like, well, who's he going to be tonight?
Yeah.
And that was a funny situation. In 70. In 1962, Roy and I were tied for first place. We both won the Downbeat Critics Award. In fact, we used to laugh about it because I was already like 33 years old, and he was 34, something like that. And it took us all that time for us to win a New Star Critics Award. You believe that?
With all the recordings and experience by that time.
Yeah, I mean, and everything he had done, everything I had done already, you know, and we're just being acknowledged as new stars, you know.
Kind of ironic.
Yeah, it was.
What did you think of that first recording, the one with Miles, with the cymbal at the beginning?
I liked it. That was very inventive, very creative at the time, you know. Roy was a creative drummer in the early days. I still think that's what killed him a little bit, because he was too creative. He was ahead of his time, you know.
Yeah. Why don't we go now just to some more recordings of Roy Haynes in the 50s. This is during the years he was with Sarah Vaughan, and Sarah made some great records for MRC. And this is from one of them with Clifford Brown, Paul Quinichet, Jimmy Jones, Joe Benjamin, Roy Haynes, and Herbie Mann. And we'll hear...
Let's see.
Oh, yeah, it's one of my favorites. It's called You're Not the Kind. And again, we just get to hear Roy here within a more... in a different context.
Mm-hmm.
With a singer, and it's a different context than with a bebop quintet like we just heard him with Charlie Parker. But yet he gets his licks in. So we'll listen to Roy Haynes with Sarah Vaughan and Clifford Brown, 1954.
Kind of a boy for a girl like me. I'm just a song and a dance, you're a symphony. I thought that you never would doubt me, but I'm telling you, you'd be much better off without me. You're just the kind of a boy who would always play fair. I'm just the kind of a girl who would never be fair. It's so hard to let you go, but it's only because I know that you're not the kind of a boy for a girl like me. Thank you. girl like me. I'm just a song and a dance, you're a symphony. I thought that you never would doubt me. But I'm telling you, you'd be much better off without me. You're just the kind of a boy who will always play fair. I'm just the kind of a girl who would never be square. It's so hard to let you go, but it's only because I know that you're not the kind of a boy. You're not the kind of a boy. You're not the kind of a boy for a girl like me.
And listen, somebody just called into us before. I mean, I might as well tell all of you in case you're having any. He was only because of the he's not getting because of stereo, which we are on.
We're in very separated stereo.
Very separated stereo. If you're having a problem, almost all good sets have a mono button. Push your mono button and mix it yourself, and you'll get everything fine. Because that's what I have to do sometimes.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just a suggestion, but it'll save maybe a few problems for some people.
Okay. We just heard Roy Haynes with Clifford Brown, Paul Quinichet, Herbie Mann, Jimmy Jones, and just a very nice setting there. We were talking about
nice,
the...
It swung nice and comfortable.
You mentioned it as far back as when we heard the title with Lester from the Royal Roost about the sound of his drums at that point, a nice caps.
Well,
the sound of the bass drum.
He knew how to tune his drums. He's always been a good
right.
tuner, you know. See, what I like about a bass drum... that gets that kind of a sound. It's the same kind of sound Tiny Khan got, you know. It's a leathery sound. It's definitely the sound of leather, because, you know, a calfskin head is leather, you know. And with the right kind of a beater hitting in exactly the right spot, it's got that punch, like the sound of a baseball hitting a catcher's glove.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful sound to me. I mean, I like it, you know. And it's something you strive for. When you get that, it's hitting directly in the center of the drum, and you can't get that with plastic if you stood on your head. I mean, it just doesn't happen.
You mentioned maybe for some of the drummers who are listening out there, they should know that there's an article in the current issue of
Modern Drummer.
About...
Yeah, it talks about the Mylar, you know, the plastic that's used for plastic drum heads. And there's a small history about the Evans Drum Company and Remo Belli's Weather King and Ludwig and all these different companies that made heads, and all the litigation as they were suing each other years ago with DuPont backing the ones it dug, you know. It was a very strange article. But in the beginning of the article, I was very proud to see that the guy who wrote the article made a point about saying that, you know, like under the right conditions, there's still nothing better than calfskin. And he says, the only person that really stands up for that notably is Mel Lewis, and outspokenly also. And I'll stand behind that anytime. I was very happy to see that the guy knows that I know what I'm talking about and that he agrees, because you still can't beat calf for feel and sound when the conditions are correct. But when they're not, you got to have your drum key in your pocket, which is what a lot of lazy drummers don't do. And, you know, they go for this, you know, you tune a plastic head, you can't get a really great sound. You can get a sound, naturally, you know. Of course you can get a sound, and of course it is a pleasure to play on plastic when it's pouring rain outside.
Like last night.
Yeah, I mean, it's helpful, let's put it that way. I don't think it's a pleasure at all. And also, you know, plastic heads get dented and they lose their finish, and you can't get a good sound on brushes after a while, you know. And they will shatter if they're struck too hard. And you know who strikes them too hard. I don't have to tell you who beats the hell out of drums. So I don't have to go into that again, which I do 1,000 times, all you rockers. See, jazz drummers never had problems with... the only problems we had with the calf heads was the weather, you know, rainy nights and humidity, heavy humidity, you know. But I think that when air conditioning came in and where the drums, like my drums at the Vanguard always are pretty much the same unless it is pouring outside, you know. In the winter, I have no problems at all because there's a certain temperature the club is kept at, and it'd be just fine all the time, you know. And if not, you put the key to it.
Right.
That's all.
We're talking with Mel Lewis. This is the History of Jazz Drums, Part 7. You're listening to WKCR-FM in New York, 89.9 on your FM dial. It's 12:53. Let's see, today is the 27th of June, 1989. So we've been going on this. We started this series back in January. So we've got quite a while to go as we take our time and stretching out with the history of jazz drums. And right now we're talking with Roy Haynes, talking about Roy Haynes and his music with Mel Lewis. And I'd like to just take a little side trip and ask Mel, we talked about other parts of the drum set. Now, obviously when we're dealing with Roy Haynes here and we first got it, first started creeping into the picture with Joe Jones and then has been magnified ever since, which is this independence of the bass drum.
Yeah.
As kind of a comping instrument during the solos and ensembles and things. I wonder if you could speak to the issue of bass drum accenting constructively, but having, as I've heard you talk about, having a basic grounding and knowing how to play 4/4 on the bass drum, and then coming out of it. Could you tell
that, that's the whole thing. See, you if you could if you play see. So many young drummers today, everything is thrown on the accent rather than on the time.
You really
should play the 4/4, which seems to be so difficult for so many people. I don't know why. You know, it seems to me that's the most basic thing there is to tap your foot four times to a bar, but to throw in the kicks where you feel them. You know, working with your right foot against your left hand, you know, so you're going chigong, gong, chigong, you know, da-da-bomb, da-da-bomb, whatever it is, why you can't still play, and your right hand's playing ding-ding-a-ding through most of this anyway, well, why can't your right foot play boom, 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 and then with boom, 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 and then boom, 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 you know, all these, and then, and when you stop that, you're right back to boom, 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 boom again. You know, I mean, it's, first of all, the swing comes from that boom, boom, boom. I mean, that's, when you're a marching, you know, we've gone through this before, when you're a marching band going down the street, what you hear coming is that bass drum. You don't hear this thing, you don't hear the afterbeat, you hear that downbeat. Boom, down, da dee 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 dee, bump, 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 bump. That's the whole scene right there. Without that, you got nothing. Rock and roll without bump, bump, chick, bump, bump, chick, bump, bump, chick, you know, nothing. You got nothing. Jazz is boom, 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 but softly with a pulse. It's a heartbeat, you know. Now, and especially if you got a good one and it swings, it means you got control. Now, of course, you can drop bombs on one, two, three, or four. Four being one of the most swinging of all beats, you know. So, boom, 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 pop, you know. Now, you want to throw an offbeat after four? Boom, 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 bump. What do you mean you can't play boom, 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 bump, boom, 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 bump, boom, 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 bump, 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 you know, because your little fills with the left hand are always going in along so that you're always, you know, you got the motion still going, and then you fall back to that 4/4 again. But if you just sit there with your foot on the pedal, like I've seen so many guys do, where the beater isn't even moving except for an occasional bang wherever they feel like putting it, first of all, there's no bottom to the beat at all. Second of all, the bass player is carrying the time. And if he starts to rush, which you're going to rush with him, you know, because you're not holding him back. You've got nothing to control anything with. But most importantly, there's no bottom to the sound, you know. And you're keeping time with your hands, and your feet are what you keep time with, not your hands. Your hands are you color with your hands. You create motion with your hands. You play your backbeat with your hands. If your foot's in the right place, your hands will definitely be in the right place, you know. And, I mean, it just doesn't make any sense that you can play. You're playing a half a set of drums. You're playing the top, and you're not playing the bottom at all. I mean, and if you can't play four beats to the bar, then you can't keep time, then you can't play the drums, you know. And all these guys, all the Roy Haynes's and the Max Roaches and the Art Blakey's and the Alvin Joneses and the Philly Joe Joneses, you know, and forget about the old timers who did it all the time. They didn't even bother with the offbeat stuff until later on. All these guys learned to play the drums playing four to the bar, and they still do, you know. I don't know any of them that don't, you know.
It just lightened up over the years.
But there's a lot of young flashes around that are making good names for themselves whose time is not that good. They don't swing that hard. Oh, they play flashy, you know. I mean, they can do all kinds of things, and they can do all kinds of tricks with their bass drum, but they don't swing. And the reason they don't swing is because they can't. They have no control of that 4-4. I'm not going to name names, but they are some very well-known guys, you know. And I don't agree with the way they play. I don't know why they never learned to do that or why they stay away from it. I mean, it's sort of foolish, you know. The routine is, oh, it's old-fashioned. Yeah, well, then is Lester Young old-fashioned? Then Charlie Parker died in 1955. I guess every time we listen to him, we're listening to an old-fashioned player. You know, not where I come from. Yeah. You know, and, you know, I mean, you just can't say that. It's stupid. You know, nothing is old-fashioned.
It's good.
What's
or it's
new?
Bad.
What is new, you know? Yeah.
It's good or it's bad, yeah, I think.
That's it.
And if it's swinging, it's good.
If it's swinging, it's good, yeah.
Let me ask you a question. This is a crazy question. I don't know if there's an answer to it. Why does it, we're sitting here with Mel Lewis, and one of the most swinging drummers that ever has been. So let me ask you a silly question. Why does it feel good when it swings? Have you ever thought of, I mean, what is it? Why is it if it's swinging, you feel better?
I don't know what it is. I don't know what it is, but I'll tell you, I've been sitting, I almost start to cry when it's swinging real good.
Yeah.
I get this very emotional feeling comes over my body.
Yeah.
It goes up my back. It's like a chill. Yeah. And you feel so good. I mean, and you look around at other people, and you see they got it too. But I mean, sometimes I'll be sitting in my living room at home listening to something that is swinging its butt off, and I'll almost cry because it just gets to me inside. But I'm crying with happiness. I mean, like, it's such a good groove, and it's such a nice feeling that you can become over-emotional, you know. Now, especially if it's my own group. Now, I know that sounds strange, but to hear something like played back, say, for the first time, like on a playback of a night at the Vanguard or something like that, and everything is just happening, I'll get this swell in my body. I'll say, my God. And, oh, you start feeling so good, and or you're hearing a solo by one of your players that is just so much, or hearing it by Sonny Rollins or Lester. That's why I say I don't want it to sound like within myself or within my own organization. But even though I'll sit and I'll hear a solo by Lovano or Oates or anybody in the band that is just so beautiful and so warm and so swinging and so good that this prideful feeling takes over. And you almost want, you get the swelling up of tears. I mean, And that's when it's happening. It's because something is really happening that's special. And, of course, when it's swinging, which is not... Listen, the greatest swinger in the world can't swing all the time. There has to be letdowns, you know. A cat that really swings will swing most of the time. You can almost depend on him that something's going to happen, like Zoot, for instance.
Yeah,
Zoot could always pick up a horn when things were dying and just make it all of a sudden... Everything just lit. He could take the worst drummer and make him sound good. Just because all you got to do is follow him, you know. And it's a marvelous feeling when Zoot would pick up his horn and take over if things weren't happening. And a lot of times he knew that too, and he'd figure it's time for me because we're dying here. It's not happening. But there are a lot of other players like that. I mean, all through the years, cats that could just make things happen that way, just with the time feel.
Like Roy
Elwards would be a natural, definitely, you know. It's always wild to hear Dizzy pick up his horn behind a whole lot of other players because he can do it too. And there are piano players like Hank Jones, Jimmy Rolls, who impeccable time. I mean, it's going to swing when he starts to play. Flanagan. That's what makes these guys so great. it ain't that their time isn't, it doesn't have to be perfect. It just feels so good. It's a feeling, you know. And, there's other people, too. I mean, you know, I'm just naming personal favorites of mine that I know I've played with them, and I know what it feels like, and I know how good it is. This is very important, you know, and this is what it's all about. But it's still based on that 4-4, because if you can't make 4-4 happen, you know, then forget it. You know, there's a drummer who plays with a famous singer, who I won't mention, who's got the worst time in the world. I mean, he can't play four beats to the bar. There's like four different spaces between each beat. And he's been with this guy for years. And when my band has had to play with this singer a couple times, they used to say to me, the lead trumpet player, Earl, would come over to me and say, should we follow him or should we just lead him? I'd say, lead him, but if so-and-so gets funny with you and starts acting up and giving you a hard time, then follow him.
Yeah. Let's take it back. I'm going to take it back right now to Roy Haynes. And
yeah, let's get back to Roy.
Why talk about that one? And listen to a recording he did with Thelonious Monk. And this is very interesting. This is done in 1958, and it's Roy Haynes, Ahmed Abdul-Malik on the bass, Johnny Griffin on the tenor, and Thelonious Monk on the piano. And naturally, it's a very, very special recording, and we'll listen to Evidence. And again, we're throwing the focus on the great Roy Haynes on the drums. You're listening to WKCR-FM in New York, 89.9 on your FM dial, The History of Drums, Part 7 with Mel Lewis.
Thank you.
The interplay on that was just fantastic between the horns and the drums. And every little fill he played practically was a different one, you know? And always in the right place and everything always leading into the thing. Solo was beautiful. And it led into that last chorus just marvelous. Roy had just great ears, great taste. Not had, it still has. I don't know. It's not everybody could do things like that. And the sound of the drums, you know.
Something
again,
very clean and crisp about it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what it is.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Always has been. Well, there's always something very clean and crisp about the way he dresses and everything. I mean, he's that kind of a guy. He's an impeccable person.
Well,
I saw him last Friday.
Yeah,
right. He was there with his hat and his looking nice, walking around, you know.
Yeah. I think he was on the Esquire 10 Best Dressed Men list or something like that.
Yeah.
At one point in the 50s, he made it on one of those, like...
He was.
All-time best dressed.
Right, I'm looking forward to seeing him tonight, you know. He's on that concert.
Talk about that. Mel, of course, is appearing as part of the JBC Jazz Festival
JBC.
And the Bebop concert at Town Hall.
And
Avery Fisher.
Right. Roy will be there, and Art Blakey, and myself.
I'm going to try and make it too. 14 minutes after one, and right now we're going to turn to an album under Roy Haynes' name. This was recorded in 1962. It's called Out of the Afternoon, the Roy Haynes Quartet, with Rahsaan Roland Kirk, Henry Grimes, and Tommy Flanagan.
Sounds good.
Quite a band. Recorded by Rudy Van Gelder, and we'll listen to If I Should Lose You. Roy Haynes on the drums.
See, now, that's some, the soloing on that, you see the respect for the melody and for the structure of the song that Roy has. You know, when the guys are playing, you know, bump, bump, you know, they're playing, I can hear like a horn playing with the breaks. You can hear it as if it was stop time. It is stop time. They played stop time for him. And he played as if he played the kind of figurations that a horn would play, a good horn player. And I think that's, so that means he's really thinking horn-wise, you know, which is the way I like to do it, too. It's really, if you know the tune and you know, if you know the tune, and even if you know the, you know the chord structure without actually knowing what chords they are, it's like, you know, it's like a lot of horn players who play by ear and always hear the right things.
Right.
It's the same idea with the drums. You're going to play choruses or phrases that are as if you were playing a tenor sax or a trombone or a trumpet or whatever, you know.
Well, I've actually been on gigs where you have, if someone who was playing wasn't sure of the tune or the melody or somewhere, where you've actually straightened this out as to where the tune went at certain points.
Oh, yeah, well, you know. You know? I know that.
Yeah.
Well, see, you get in the habit of breathing the same as the players do. You get to, you know the tune so well, you know, and you're thinking, that's why you know how to do the right things at the end of phrases or bringing them in. You know, that's how you inspire. If you don't know the tune, if you don't know the tune at all, it's not a matter. Some guys say, what was it? Was it 32 bars? Was it 12 bars? Was it 16 bars? Was it 34 bars? Is there a tag? Yeah. Then they start counting. You know, I mean, if you have to do that, you're lost. You're dead. I mean, if you're playing an original, if somebody says, we're going to play this tune you don't know, and it's not based on anything, they might say, it's just 32 bars. You know, they'll say it that way. If it's based on a tune, I would always prefer that they tell you what the tune is, because then you can think the tune, you know, just like they are when they're blowing, you know.
Yeah.
But if it's just a tune, man, they should just tell you the tune, and you should know the tune, and then you can think as musically as everybody else.
Yeah. When we heard Roy Haynes with Thelonious Monk, we heard Evidence.
Yeah.
And someone even called to say, I know what that is. That's the chord changes to Just You, Just Me.
Yeah.
And on Roy's solo, I heard it.
Yeah.
I heard the bridge, you know.
Because he knew it too.
Yeah. Yeah. We're talking with Mel Lewis about Roy Haynes. And right now we're going to hear our last track with Roy Haynes for this afternoon. And it's very special because when the famous original John, well, not original, but the famous John Coltrane Quartet with McCoy Tyner, Jimmy Garrison, and Elvin Jones would need a sub in the drum chair, it was always...
Always Roy.
Always Roy Haynes.
Sure.
And that was the hot seat of the early 1960s, as everyone knows, and as we'll find out in great detail when we get to Elvin Jones a few shows down from here. What we're going to do is hear something recorded live at the Newport Jazz Festival, July 7th, 1963. And we'll hear My Favorite Things with McCoy Tyner, Jimmy Garrison, and Roy Haynes. Let me ask you, Mel, before we hear the track, why was it Roy Haynes who got the call?
Well, because Roy was the original avant-garde drummer. I mean, I think he understood Coltrane and the music as well as Elvin did, you know. Going all the way back to the 40s, like I said, and like a lot of other people have said, and like Roy himself knows, he said it himself, actually, and not that in a bragging manner, that he was into a very progressive style of playing long before Elvin came along, you know. Elvin was in the right place at the right time with Train, and he and Train together were something fantastic. Now, if Roy would have been... If there had been no Elvin, and there had been Roy and Train, it would have been the same thing. It would have been a little different as far as, you know, thoughts, because they're two different people. But it would have been just as exciting and just as strong and just as important. You know, and a lot more people would be talking about Roy Haynes today than they are. Because, you know, they would have had an opportunity to hear two giants again. Roy is also was one of those very confident people that could sit down and anticipate, you know, or inspire, you know, like he did with Prez, which was a different style, you know. See, a lot of people don't know Elvin. Well, we'll talk about Elvin when we get to his show. But Elvin could play straight ahead, too, with people like J.J., and where he just swung them out of the place, you know, but without getting into that thing he did with Train because he hadn't even gotten to that yet. You couldn't do that with just anybody. Roy was trying to do things like that with people that didn't even appreciate it, which is why I made that statement earlier that Roy was before his time, which probably hurt him a little bit because he was too modern. So, you know, he did the smartest thing. He went out and worked with Sarah and settled down. When he came back, I mean, he hadn't changed, but by that time, things, music just changed.
Kind of caught up.
Yeah.
Well, right now we're going to hear Roy Haynes, who actually was the only drummer, I guess, who worked steadily and who recorded as a regular kind of member with Charlie Parker, Lester Young, and John Coltrane.
He was very much appreciated by the Giants, you know, because he himself was a Giant, you know.
And is, as you mentioned before. Oh, yeah. Should mention that the material of Roy Haynes with John Coltrane has been collected onto a reissue album called To the Beat of a Different Drum, and on a double album on Impulse, ABC Impulse, and they put out all the recordings of Roy Haynes and Coltrane together if you'd like to check them out. Anyway, this is My Favorite Things, one of the signature tunes for John Coltrane, and here is To the Beat of a Different Drummer. It's Roy Haynes with the John Coltrane Quartet, 1963.
Thank you. Thank you. John Coltrane, McCoy Tyner, Jimmy Garrison, Roy Haynes.
Well, we didn't need an announcer to tell us that. But that was John Coltrane, the John Coltrane Quartet, with McCoy Tyner, Jimmy Garrison, and Roy Haynes from July 7th, 1963. And we heard My Favorite Things with Roy Haynes on the drums.
Yeah, you know, and man, he took care of business there. I mean, you know, it's, I'm sure if somebody else tuned in and didn't know that it wasn't Elvin, they would think it was, you know.
Yeah. It was funny. It was totally different than Elvin, but on the other hand, everything else proceeded as normal.
Right. But it was that, yeah, that wonderful triplet feel and, you know, a lot of motion and a lot of fire, a lot of inspiration. It was good. It was great.
We'll probably get into, we'll definitely get into this more and more as we proceed with the series when we get into Elvin Jones, because there are a lot of questions I want to ask you about what happened in the John Coltrane Quartet. But suffice it to say, as you said before, the fact that Roy Haynes got the call for that and made all these marvelous recordings is quite a tribute to his.
Yeah, he's about the only guy at that time that I think that could have done it. You probably find some guys, other guys that could do it today, because they've had the experience of hearing the group.
Of listening to them.
Sure.
Yeah.
But at that time, Roy was probably the best choice.
Yeah.
Without a doubt.
It's 1:39. You're listening to The History of Jazz Drums, Part 7, with yours truly, Lauren Schoenberg, and our very special guest this afternoon, Mr. Mel Lewis. And right now we're going to go from Roy Haynes to Mr. Philly Joe Jones.